Let's take a brief look at structuring unstructured logic. I want to remind you of the characteristics that all structured programs have. This list is in your book. Rather than have me read each line, again, this is just a brief explanation with a couple of specific examples. I'm going to point out that this second bullet, each of the structures has a single entry point and a single exit point. I'm pointing that one out because one of our unstructured examples has this error in it. It has an error related to this. The loop structure contains a decision triangle and a process rectangle. The process rectangle is referred to as the body of the loop. If the evaluation of this decision results in a yes, then the body of the loop is performed. If the decision evaluates to no, then the loop ends. We leave the loop structure. Okay. The purpose of a loop to repeat processes if necessary. So the flow lines for the yes will go directly back to right directly above the decision. What we're not seeing here, because it is not part of the loop structure, is that there has to be a process somewhere in the program before this decision. That process has to be there because it has to set a sentinel value, or the priming read, so that this decision has some sort of data to evaluate in order to decide what to do. So again, that process A in this example has to occur before this decision B, but it is not necessarily part of the loop. If the decision B evaluates to yes, the flow goes to process C, and then back to the decision again to ask the question, or to do the evaluation, to determine do we continue with the loop, do another iteration, or do we exit the loop. So that's a basic loop structure explained. Let's look at an example. Here's an example of unstructured flowchart. Notice the first thing, that the flow arrow from process C does not go where it's supposed to go. This flow arrow should go directly above the decision. It should go here. That process A that we're seeing it here. That needs to be here. That does the priming read or initializing the sentinel value. That has to be there, but it's not part of the loop. Remember, our loop arrow, flow arrow, is going to come here. So B makes a decision and or does an evaluation, and if it's yes, we go to C. C is not the same process as A. Otherwise, it would be named A. And since it's not, it doesn't do the same thing A does. Because C does not do the same thing as A, then the sentinel value is not modified. So we would end up in an infinite loop here. Because the sentinel value is not being modified, it's being evaluated again, and if it evaluated to yes the first time, and it's never changed, it's going to evaluate to yes the next time, and every time, now we have an infinite loop. Okay? We don't want an infinite loop. So the other problem with this unstructured logic is we need to have a repeat of the process A so that that sentinel value can be modified. So that's how we would fix this unstructured flowchart. Let's look at another example, a little bit more complicated. I'm going to explain what's happening here. First of all, process D sets that sentinel value, does the priming read. Decision E evaluates that sentinel value. If it evaluates to yes, we go to process H. H does whatever it does, and then H sends the logic flow down to process I. Process I does whatever it does, and it exits this block of structure. What happens if that sentinel value that is set in process D. If it evaluates to no, then the flow goes to process F. Process F does whatever it does, and looks like it's setting some sort of, or modifying some sort of sentinel value for this decision G. If the decision G evaluates to yes, it wants to go to process I and do process I. The problem is, this violates that single entry point. Notice this would be two arrows. That means two entry points. No, we don't want that. So what we're going to do is we're going to, just like we did with the previous example where we repeated process A in a different location, we're going to do the same thing here. We're going to repeat process I and draw G's flow arrow like this. Yes, we've got two different processes of I. They do the exact same thing. But this is how we know that it's structured, because one entry point here, one entry point there. After I is finished processing, we want it to exit the logic. But if we come straight down, now we've got two exit points, an exit point here and an exit point here. We don't want that. So what we're going to do is try to erase this stuff and change our flow line to be something like this. The no comes over here and down and over. The I comes down and over. And then we have the flow arrow from this decision. Notice that's a decision block. That flow arrow is going to come over and be this one right here. I'm going to show you a little bit better looking example of that. And actually, it's one of the examples given in the graphics in the book. So we're untangling. I realize this example from the book is using different reference letters. I'm going to back up a slide. Here we're using HI, G, and we're using some different letters over here, but it's the same concept. Instead of having this flow arrow go straight across from this decision to get to J, we're going to repeat process J. So they're drawing this flow arrow for J. They're getting rid of this. Now, what we're not seeing in this diagram, in this example, is that these lines would come over here together and then they exit the structure. Again, this example is explained in a little more detail in your book, but on pages 111 to 115, if you follow through, it'll show you how to untangle a pretty good mess, and it comes out pretty logically structured when it's finished. This is exercise 2C from your assignment. Now, I'm not going to show you how to do this one, but basically, it's the same type of unstructured mistakes.